How you doing? Doing good?
Good.
I'll try. This year teaching and singing haven't been matched.
Are you a year eater?
No, I'm this one.
Eastern, right?
Yeah, well, would have been the bulk of the fun of farming to Eastern. Didn't work out in the amount of students we have. Out of all the schools, we have 150 more students in that school.
Really?
They're trying all, I don't know if they're trying to do all our teams to see this math, but it's like, every room has like, I have one of the smallest one, I have 17.
Your classroom teacher?
Yes.
Are you teaching book or are you teaching?
Second, third.
Second, third. That's where Carrie Hansen is. Was Carrie Hansen teaching at Martin Mayer when you were in school? Where is that?
Yeah, and it's like, we have like four kindergarten.
Yeah.
We actually have four kindergarten. We have two English and then we have one Spanish. First and one that is kindergarten. Basically, the program needs two teachers per grade and another one. Meaning like two kinders by the way. But we don't have the people. Or the rooms, or the. I think we take the rooms, then we basically push out the one. It's like. So it's a.
So maybe to either build a school or.
I don't know. They're trying multiple choices because it's so mean to our only one school. We have to support the building from, but. And it's like, I mean, so maybe we just need to turn one to bilingual, just like say for like perfect hand. But as soon as somebody mentions somebody else, it's like segregations immediately. It's like we just don't have the resources to have to cover for schools or not even two. Like last year, so we split into two. And we're barely being able to manage that. We don't even make it to the two. We only have reserved for our operation.
Yeah.
I'm not going to go on fire.
Yes, I'm not in Argentina, Oregon. I'm in Mexico.
Where?
Argentina, Oregon, and here's the
theater. Okay. So you're traveling today?
I do. I drive out there every day.
Okay.
It's working out fine. I'm enjoying being there.
How was your experience at high school?
What's that?
How was your experience at high school?
It was good until the last year. Last year started getting more difficult. So there were things that I just don't even remember real well. And I saw like the time being one. So I hope Sarah's still singing. I don't know.
Mostly depending on you.
No, I know, I think that way, well,
Yeah. Welcome to First Mennonite Church today, and whether you're live here in the sanctuary or joining us on Zoom or YouTube, it's always great to be part of this worship service with our family here. Today's theme is love as an act of wisdom. I have to admit, initially, I didn't quite understand how this plays out in our lives. Wisdom isn't a straightforward action word to me, and I guess I don't think of it as something that everybody's gifted with. Lots of times I wonder whether people are gifted with wisdom. We're going to hear in the scriptures and from Michael today how Jesus calls us to use wisdom in ways that we don't normally hear in our current environment. Much like the Beatitudes, wisdom almost sounds counterintuitive. The meek shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You're going to hear in Luke that happy are you when people hate you and reject you. This sounds kind of counterintuitive. I, for one, am looking forward to hearing how we can show love through wisdom that is available to us as we grow in our life as followers of Jesus. May we be receptive to the words that call us into the action to love. Let's pray. Passionate God, renew us in your love, O God, and heal us with the comfort of your abundant love. Awaken us in the role that we can play in healing your creation. May we gain wisdom through the power of the Holy Spirit to hear your word and move forward in faith. Amen. We're going to sing hymn number 4.
Thank you.
standing for the call to worship. And this is taken inspiration, let's say, by Luke 6, 17 to 26. From the comfort of our Western homes and prosperous lives,
we become hungry for a better world for all.
In our society divided by power struggles and prejudice,
we affirm the power of your healing love.
With the honesty of our doubts and insecurities, we rejoice in your love for each one of us, seeking your blessing to make us whole. Keep standing for I Sing the Mighty Power of God, hymn 182. Marsha Nelson will be sharing a story. Let the children come to me. Let the
I'm glad to see you. This is a pretty big crowd. And we have the basket here where Malia and Naima's grandfather works for the United Front for River Blindness, and thank you for your contributions. So I have a book today that's an old book, and it's the librarian at Champaign Library helped me find it, and it's called Titch. Titch is a little boy. Titch was little. His sister, Mary, was a bit bigger, and his brother, Pete, was a lot bigger. Pete had a great big bike, and Mary had a big bike, too. And Titch had a little tricycle. Pete had a kite that flew high above the trees, and Mary had a kite that flew above the houses. Having trouble. And Titch had a pinwheel that he held in his hand. How does he look? Does he look happy? Not really. No. Pete had a big drum, and Mary had a trumpet. And Titch had a little wooden whistle. Pete had a big saw. Mary had a hammer. And Titch held the nails. Pete had a big spade, and Mary had a flower pot. But Titch had a tiny seed. Now take a look at him there. Does he look so sad or not so much?
Not so much.
Right, not so much. He looks like, what does he look like? He knows something. And Titch's seed, so they, I must have missed something here. So he plants the seed, and Titch's seed grew and grew
and grew.
And grew, yeah. And it got really big, didn't it? So he... That's right. It's taller than any of them. Exactly. So which person in this story had the most important thing?
The biggest one.
Pete?
The littlest person.
I'm sorry, I can't hear. Which boy?
The little person.
The little boy, right. So, the little person. So soon Michael's going to read to us from the Bible about wisdom and about people who can see God's kingdom, which sometimes we call the upside down kingdom, because the world tells us that bigger is better and stronger is better and richer is better. But those who are wise can see over and over again in the Bible and now how God uses little people to do God's work and sometimes even shame the powerful. So think about it. God sent a baby, for heaven's sakes, to be our savior. Why not a king? Why not an army? A baby. But who is easier to love than a baby?
God.
Yeah? Well, maybe. So the upside down kingdom. Things are just not what you think. And sometimes God's ways are hard to figure. And that's why we come to church week after week to learn to be wise. And I'm glad that we're here together. Okay, you can go back to your seats.
Today the scriptures are coming from 1 Corinthians and Luke. And so, and they're coming from the common Bible, so it's a little bit different than your pew Bible would read. 1 Corinthians 1, 26 to 30. Look at your situation when you were called, brothers and sisters. By ordinary human standards, not many were wise, not many were powerful, not many were from the upper class. But God chose what the world considers foolish to shame the wise. God chose what the world considers weak to shame the strong. And God chose what the world considers low class and low life, what is considered to be nothing, to reduce what is considered to be something to nothing. So no human being can brag in God's presence. It is because of God that you are in Christ Jesus. He became wisdom from God for us. This means he made us righteous and holy, and he delivered us. 1 Corinthians 2:6 to 9. What we say is wisdom to people who are mature. It isn't a wisdom that comes from the present day or from today's leaders who are being reduced to nothing. We talk about God's wisdom, which has been hidden as a secret. God determined this wisdom in advance, before time began, for our glory. It is a wisdom that none of the present day rulers have understood, because if they understood it, we would never have crucified the Lord of glory. But this is precisely what is written. God has prepared things for those who love him that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, that haven't crossed the mind of any human being. God has revealed these things to us through the Spirit. The Spirit searches everything, including the depths of God. And then in Luke 6:17-26, we hear, Jesus came down from the mountain with them and stood on a large area of level ground. A great company of his disciples and a huge crowd of people from all over Judea and Jerusalem and the area around Tyre and Sidon joined him there. They came to hear him and be healed from their diseases, and those bothered by unclean spirits were healed. The whole crowd wanted to touch him because power was going out from him, and he was healing everyone. Happy people and doomed people. Jesus raised his eyes to his disciples and said, "Happy are you who are poor, because God's kingdom is yours. Happy are you who hunger now, because you will be satisfied. Happy are you who weep now, because you will laugh. Happy are you when people hate you and reject you and insult you and condemn your name as evil because of the human one. Rejoice when that happens. Leap for joy, because you have a great reward in heaven." Their ancestors did the same things to the prophets. "But how terrible for you who are rich because you have already received your comfort. How terrible for you who have plenty now because you will be hungry. How terrible for you who laugh now because you will mourn and weep. How terrible for you who all speak well of you." The ancestors did the same things to the false prophets.
Good morning. Love as an act of wisdom. Wisdom plays a big role in the biblical tradition, as Martha said. God creates and rescues and delegates and calls and saves all through the spiritual power of wisdom. Jesus teaches and lives by the spiritual power of wisdom. His way of love, the way of the cross, which is counterintuitive or hidden to some, as Paul says, is grounded in the same deep wisdom that roots oak trees in the soil and pumps blood through our bodies. By God's wisdom, this way of love flows in sync with the very grain of the universe. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. Today is a big day. Fans have been waiting all year for it. You know what I'm talking about. This is Superb Owl Sunday. Owl enthusiasts the world over are collecting their best owl picks and posting them to social media. Some will head out at dusk in hopes of glimpsing their nocturnal neighbors. Superb Owl is indeed a real thing. It's also a joke that started because of the absurd trademark rules governing the name of the National Football League's big game, the other big thing that's apparently happening today. And since we're live on YouTube, I'm not going to say that game's name out loud for fear of bringing the full wrath of the FCC down on FMC. We are governed by broadcast copyrights, by the way. Some trace the origins of Superb Owl Sunday to the fact that the words Superb Owl trend on Google at this time every year. It's a really common typo. Just try typing it three times fast and see what happens. The tapping the B on the keyboard just before the space bar instead of just after it. So some clever birders capitalized on the search error. And by the way, I did test this with Google, and not surprisingly, Google embraces the joke, and the first thing that pops up is a picture of an owl dressed as a football fan with details about the so-called big game. Now, none of this really has much at all to do with 1 Corinthians, except that it's a neat illustration of one of the challenges we have in translating the Greek New Testament manuscripts into our modern English translations. Scribes of biblical Greek wrote in what's called continuous script. So it was all capital letters, no spaces between letters, no spaces between words, and no punctuation marks. And often the text would just run from one line right on to the next. So it would go left to right, your left to right, middle of a word, and then the word would just pick up and keep going here. And then they also developed all kinds of funky abbreviations for words that happened a lot. But then later scribes would come by and not know the abbreviation system, and they choose a different word, and this is how you get different manuscript traditions that develop. So we have to decide where sentences end and where clauses break based on context or grammar. And you might be surprised how much context and grammar help a lot. But if the Apostle Paul wrote about Superb Owl Sunday, we would have to guess if he is an American football fan or an ornithological enthusiast. Okay, put a pin in that. Superb Owl Sunday doesn't generally show up in the church's calendar for good reason, but February 14th, tomorrow, does. Most of what we know about Valentine's Day, we know from Hallmark, you know, the pink and red infused celebration of romantic love with lots of things to buy. Quirky cards, boxes of chocolates, overappreciated candy hearts, long waits at restaurants, and gender norms that no one really seems happy with, but everyone seems happy to play along with. But the capitalist holiday does have its origins in a different place. Valentine of Terni. There are about a dozen different legends of St. Valentine. This is probably the best attested one. Valentine of Terni was a 3rd century Roman priest who is commonly associated with the one we call Saint Valentine, the patron saint of lovers. Less commonly known is that Valentine of Terni was executed, beheaded in fact, at the order of Emperor Claudius II, probably on February 14th in the year 271. Now, in Valentine's Day, that's the original Valentine's Day, male soldiers in the imperial army were forbidden by law from getting married. Claudius II wasn't the only Roman emperor who enforced this law, but he does seem to have been especially harsh about it. There's lots of military annals reporting soldiers running off and getting married against the law, and there's not really anything that the emperor can do about it except to kick them out of his army, which of course he doesn't want to do. So it's one of those laws that's really awkward. But apparently Claudius II was especially convinced that single men made better soldiers than those with wives and families. Fewer distractions or something. But Saint Valentine protested. Why should men drafted into the emperor's army be forbidden the opportunity to bind their love with sacred promises? Why should they not have the blessing of God on the love that gives their lives meaning and hope? Well, the rulers of any age, to use Paul's language, don't like to share allegiances. That was the emperor's real concern. As a priest, Valentine's protest to the singular demands of absolute power was to go ahead and bless love anyway. He performed marriages in secret, scattering Christ's blessing of love with total disregard for the demands of the emperor or the apparent needs of the army. Far from cartoonish cupids hanging from clouds ready to shoot magical matchmaking arrows, the real Saint Valentine was beheaded for foolishly believing that the love between a husband and wife was more important than the military success of an entire empire. If the emperor believed it was unwise to allow soldiers to marry, Saint Valentine believed it was folly not to bless love. So he's not the patron saint of expensive date nights. He is the patron saint and martyr of the kind of love that resists hegemonic power. From this side of history, it's not hard to hear Saint Valentine's story without thinking of the 2015 Supreme Court ruling that prohibits states from banning marriage for same-gender couples. Or just a bit further back, the 1967 ruling in the case of Richard and Mildred Loving, known as Loving versus Virginia, which prohibits states from banning interracial marriage. And several families here at FMC know deeply and personally what these rulings have meant then and now for them and their love. And I'm sure they can testify to what happens when a wisdom shaped by love rejects the folly of long-established social norms that serve no one except the absolute rulers of the age. It's the kind of wisdom that's born in love and tested through the flames of hate. Because you see, God chose what the world wrongly calls foolish to shame the wise. God chose what the world wrongly calls weak to shame the strong. This sort of wisdom is an act of love. The Apostle Paul wrote this letter to the Corinthian church. He says in verse 26, to remind them of their calling. You see, they weren't much to brag about. Not many of you were wise by human standards, Paul says in verse 26, meaning they didn't have much formal education. Not many of you were powerful. They didn't hold positions of authority in the government or in their jobs. They worked for people, not over them. Not many of you were of noble birth. There were no inherited titles or large trust funds. It's not in spite of these circumstances, says Paul, but because of them that God has called and anointed them to be a community built on the foundations of love. Paul brings up their low status, their lack of impressive credentials to remind them that they were called to follow Jesus, and Jesus himself had a rather unimpressive resume. He was not born into power. He had no earthly treasure, no Greek philosophical degrees to proudly display on his CV. Yet this Jesus is the one we call the Christ, God's own anointed, the one who, quote, became for us the wisdom of God. That's verse 30. And then in the next breath at the beginning of chapter 2, Paul reminds them that right from the start, he had come proclaiming a divine mystery, not something easily captured by eloquent words or perfect speech. Paul clarifies in a famous line in chapter 2, verse 2, which is actually in the section that we didn't read earlier today, in between the two sections that Martha read. And the line goes, "For I decided to be concerned about nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." Okay, remember the superb owl? I said it didn't have anything to do with 1 Corinthians, but I kind of lied, or just bent the truth a little bit. This phrase at the end of verse 2, "and him crucified," is a superb owl. Remember, there's no punctuation in the manuscripts, so translators have to make their best guess. Most of our translations have a simple comma. "For I decided to be concerned about nothing among you except Jesus Christ, comma, and him crucified." When we read it like that, it sounds like that final clause is clarifying what Paul was laser-focused on preaching about Christ, that is, about his crucifixion. But we know from other parts of the letter that the good news Paul preached to the Corinthians was more than just the crucifixion. We read this passage last week, chapter 15, where he says that the core of what he preached to the Corinthians was Jesus alive, Jesus buried, Jesus raised up, or Jesus alive, Jesus dead, Jesus buried, Jesus raised up, and Jesus handed on through the testimony of those who continue to meet him in the Spirit. Paul never limits the good news to Jesus's execution. So something else is happening here in verse 2 of chapter 2. We've got a superb owl, this text, a bit. Make a little change in the comma to a semicolon, or the increasingly popular M dash, perhaps, and we get a little different twist. "For I decided to be concerned about nothing among you except Jesus, God's anointed." That's my translation for Christ, God's anointed. "I decided to be concerned about nothing among you except Jesus, God's anointed," semicolon, "yes," exclamation mark, "the very same one who was crucified." Let me say that again. "When I was with you," Paul says, "I wanted you to know only about Jesus who is God's anointed. Yes, God's anointed is the very same one who was crucified." Can you see now how that reinforces the point that Paul was just making about how the wisdom of God revealed in Christ, the same wisdom that calls people who are not wise by worldly standards and not rich by worldly standards and not powerful by worldly standards, that same wisdom of God revealed in Christ is foolishness to the world or to the rulers of this age. Now this is this next bit is your semi-regular reminder of what it meant to be crucified. And for those of you who've been hearing me preach for a while, this is my broken record sermon. Because I think we very easily, from our position in history and relative positions of privilege, forget what it means to have been crucified. To be arrested, betrayed by his friends, to be arrested, to be tried, to be convicted. A person has to be convicted to get the death penalty. To be convicted as an enemy of the state, a terrorist, to then be violently dehumanized, to be humiliated, and eventually, as the narrative of those who execute the crucifixion would have it, eventually erased from history. So now imagine with me what ridicule must have fallen on those in the Roman world, like the people in this little church in Corinth, who called a crucified person God's anointed. This is the world where Caesar claimed the title of Christ, God's anointed. It's in the text. Caesar claimed the power of Lord and the glory of Savior. These are all titles that Caesar attributes to himself. And in that world, here were uneducated, powerless, poor people running around claiming that Jesus of Nazareth, yes, you've heard about him, the very same one whom Caesar's political appointee executed for refusing to fall in line, that's the one these lowly Corinthians were calling Savior and Lord and anointed of God. That's foolishness, right? This is not a wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age, says Paul in verse 6. It is God's wisdom, secret and hidden, things that God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit knows everything, even the depths, the innermost parts of God. That's verse 10. God's wisdom is revealed in this one who teaches us how to truly love. That's your calling. That's where you come from spiritually, Paul says. No one has greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. That's the Gospel of John. This is the wisdom of the cosmos, the grain of the universe, what bell hooks describes as a willing act of self-extension on behalf of myself or others. True love, even for myself, is self-giving and expansive. It requires risk and vulnerability and openness to change. The challenge for us, I think, is that the wisdom of this age, the rulers of this age, the principalities and powers of this age are not often kind to those who seek to live an enlarged life of love, that risky, open, vulnerable kind of love. The theologian Herbert McCabe, who's Dominican, writes about God's anointed, about the executed one. And he says, "In the world we have made, in the world we have made, it is fatal to be human, to be really human, to be open and vulnerable to others, to be loving." And then he says, "Jesus died for being this kind of human." We are called to this kind of age-defying love as an act of spiritual wisdom because in the inner heart of God, at the depths of God's Spirit, it is revealed that this kind of love is the true source of all life. It's the humming heartbeat of heaven that keeps the earth spinning and the stars shining and the waters flowing and our lungs breathing and our truly spiritual bodies alive. The love of God's anointed, yes, the very same one who was crucified, calls out to us from the inner heart of God. This is our calling and our destiny. I think whatever else we say about the Apostle Paul, and there's, you know, lots of nits to pick and whatnot, one of the more impressive things about his witness is that he is obsessed with declaring a miracle, proclaiming something new, something possible that was previously impossible. Because you see, that little church in Corinth should never have happened. This world we have made is fatal to a community like this, to one that shatters the inequalities between Jew and Greek. This is earlier in chapter 1. Shatters the inequalities between poor and rich, between slave and free. It's a miracle of God that this cruciform little church even exists, that rich and poor would come together in a spirit of mutual sharing to make a world of equal spiritual and economic power. According to the wisdom of this age, this should not be. Its existence is an impossibility. According to the conventional wisdom, those without education do not have knowledge worth giving. According to the rules of governance, those outside the systems of power do not have power over their own lives. According to the rules of economics, those without wealth do not have access to abundance. According to the rules of race and gender, some should not know true love. According to the rules of engagement, money is power and weapons are power and might is power. According to the law that crucified Jesus, the whole spiritual project of self-giving love was supposed to be pronounced dead on arrival. Yet, thanks be to God, it is not so. The wisdom of God's love opens up a different way. The wisdom of God's love raises up a people where there was none. The wisdom of God's love is a blessing that will not be contained. Amen. May it be so.
Thank you.
Ushers are going to be coming down the middle aisle and the side aisles to collect today's offering. So let's bow our heads for this time. God, we bring our gifts of money, talents, and praise for you this morning. May you find our actions pleasing in your sight. Amen.